And welcome to Nancy's Neighborhood, folks, and it's good to be with you. I'm going to tell you a little bit about my schedule. This is the last show that I'll be doing this year. I'm hoping to get some things on for fillers, like if any of the schools have videos of their musicals that they've done, their Christmas music, et cetera, et cetera. I'm hoping to get them on to fill some time. But I'm going to take some time off and prop my feet up and enjoy it. But right now I'm having a 50% off all Christmas at the Red Ribbon, and that'll go through the rest of this week and Christmas Eve. And so if you want to come by and get some last-minute Christmas things, that's great. But I'll be back here, I believe it's January the 14th that I'll be back to tape. And so I'm glad to have Judy Baker on with me today. Judy's a friend. She's also a member of Allied Arts with me, and she's a member of the Cleveland Storytelling Guild. So welcome, Judy.
Thanks for having me.
I'm so glad to have you on here because the storytellers are a very unique group of people. So tell us about the Storytelling Guild.
Well, the Guild actually began, I think their first meeting was in 1991.
Okay.
A bunch of people, I think Millie Sieber, Maureen Olin, several other people like that. A lot of them were school teachers, but they got together and started a group, and instead of calling it a club or a circle, they started a guild.
Good for them.
And we've been going ever since then. You know, this year, you know, we did lose Maureen.
Yes, we did. Wonderful storyteller.
One of the founding members, and she has left a hole in our organization.
I'm sure she has.
We really, really miss her, but learned so much from her. Mm-hmm. And we're all better tellers for having been around her. But they started with working with each other, perfecting stories, finding stories, researching stories, and that's what we still do.
And I love it because you have a lot of input on the spirits, legends, and lores that we do every year for during the month of October.
Yeah,
depending
yeah.
on when we can work it in. Because I know you have, I'm trying to think of the right word, embellished
yeah.
some stories.
I've adapted and embellished.
And adapted and embellished some of the stories we use there, which I think is great because, you know, you don't want to do the same thing every year.
No.
Because you want people to come back.
Right. And even if it is the same story, we will always get a different teller.
Right.
And that teller takes the information that they've gotten and they can put their own way they
yeah,
would
their
do
own little
it.
Twist on it.
When we've done the mausoleum story, it's always been different people and mm-hmm. different points of view. Deborah and Naren Holland wrote a cute little song that goes
yes,
with it.
Yes, she did.
So each teller, even if it's the same story, it's still going to sound different.
That's exactly right. And a lot of us get to an age where it could be the same person in the very same story the next year, and I won't remember it having been that way, you know? So that's another thing that makes it great. So Judy is very talented. Now, you're not just a locally known storyteller. You're regional,
uh-huh.
state?
Regional, yeah.
Okay.
Regional. I have told as a new voice at the Storytelling Festival of Carolina in Laurinburg.
Okay.
I have told a couple of years, and I think I'm invited back to the Georgia Mountain, which will be in Blairsville in the spring.
Oh, how neat.
The same weekend as Cherries again.
That is not neat.
That
I
is
need
not
to
neat.
Get with them and tell them to quit doing that.
But I served as an MC last year, did a beginning storyteller's workshop, led a session for children, and then told in the regional showcase. And hopefully we'll be doing that again. I've told at the Union City Corn Fest.
And I know where Union City is.
All the way in West Tennessee.
Boy, it is.
I mean, it is.
You cannot go. When you get to Union City, if you go any further, you're not in Tennessee anymore.
No. In fact, we went to Kentucky to eat supper.
Oh, gosh.
A lot of places like that. I'll be one of the new voices at the Cumberland Falls Storytelling Festival in March.
Neat.
In Corbin, Kentucky. I told there last year. I actually won their Liars Contest.
I don't know whether to congratulate you on that or not, winning the Liars Contest. I love it.
But I told a story. I did win. I do have an award with a certificate of authenticity in my office.
Very good.
And I did have to retire. When you win, you do retire for 3 years.
Oh.
So.
You can't be a liar again for 3 years.
You can't for at least 3 years to give the other aspiring up-and-coming liars
a chance. I love it. That's fantastic.
It is the sweetest festival. And people think I have to go to Jonesboro, you know, to the big one, to the national. I'm going to hear the big people. Mm-hmm. You can hear the big people in Blairsville next spring. You can hear the big people at Cumberland Falls next spring. You'll hear one of the big people on February the 1st for Okoye Story Fest. And you don't have to spend the big bucks that you would to go to Jonesboro to do it and hear the same tellers. We bring them to the area.
And I think that's awesome. And what I love about your Storytelling Guild is that we rely on you all with Cherry's money mm-hmm. every year to bring a international storyteller in to the schools.
Some of our tellers have told internationally. Megan Hicks, that we had a few years ago, went to New Zealand recently.
Oh, my goodness.
We'll have Kim Whitecamp will be our teller for...
We've had Kim before.
We had Kim before, and she actually came back to Black Fox School and recorded 2 award-winning CDs.
That's right. I remember now. Yes. Mm-hmm. 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 So she's coming back.
This will be our 24th.
Oh, I love it. I think it's great.
And I've already got her scheduled for 5 schools.
Fantastic.
Just waiting for confirmation of a time on 1 school, but that's all right. We know we'll be there in the morning.
Right.
So it's all good. The concert, and that's what they're called,
the concert.
Mm-hmm. Will be Friday evening, February the 1st, back at the Museum Center. With some changes down there, we're back home.
Okay, good.
Where we've had it for years and years mm-hmm. and years, and so much good support from Jan and everybody down at the museum for storytelling in our area.
Right.
They realize the history of storytelling here in Appalachia.
Absolutely, and they are our Appalachian history museum, so they need to be sure they encourage our storytelling.
And I've had the privilege of going down there several times when they've had field trips and been able to share traditional stories.
How neat.
Down there when they've had field trips. I think we've had our last one for the year, but...
You would think,
since
we're where we are
school
in the year.
Is out this week.
Yes.
But we'll start back up hopefully next spring, early, after testing probably. Mm-hmm. But... Even during the summer, we've had camps down there, and it's a wonderful thing to teach a 4-year-old crisscross applesauce.
I'm sure it is. So now we're talking about Appalachian history, mm-hmm. and the month of January is Appalachian History Heritage Month, and so the museum is going to celebrate all month of January. But one thing that the Storytellers Guild is going to do, you're going to do the 4th annual Old Christmas on the 10th of January at the museum. Now, you and I talked about this because Old Christmas, well, you explain it.
Well, Old Christmas came about when the changeover, Pope Gregory decided the Julian calendar didn't align with the seasons correctly. So in the 1500s, he decided to change Christmas from December the 25th. And there's a whole story about why Christmas is on December the 25th.
Right.
But... on January the 6th, and he decided to move it back
to the 25th of December,
losing 12 days. Mm-hmm. People thought, where are my 12 days?
Right.
I've lost 12 days.
Right.
He's taken 12 days away from me. And he hadn't.
They were still there.
It was just a realignment of the calendar.
Right.
But in the 1750s, when Great Britain decided to adopt their Gregorian calendar, the colonies also adopted the Gregorian calendar. Say that 15 times.
No, I can't. Thank you. That's the reason you're telling this story.
When the settlers, the Scots-Irish in particular, came into Appalachia, they had already been celebrating on January the 6th. And either they didn't get the word or they got the word and ignored it.
Which we didn't have cell phones back then, so they may not have gotten the word.
Not many newspapers either.
That's right.
And knowing the stubbornness,
oh gosh, yes,
they went along with what they wanted to do. Mm-hmm. And for years, they celebrated Old Christmas on January the 6th, but along came New Christmas. And that period of 12 days became known as Breaking Up Christmas, because after New Christmas on the 25th, you go to your friend's house, and then you go to your next friend's house, and you go to your next friend's house, all the way up to January the 5th. There would be dancing, there'd be storytelling, they'd have food. You know, it'd be bad weather, you couldn't do much else. So they went from house to house, they danced. They had play parties, which was dancing in disguise if your neighborhood was inclined to not dance.
Right. Creative movement.
Creative movement. Mm-hmm. And they'd have food and they'd sing, they'd have music, and they would celebrate up until midnight on the 5th.
And Judy and I were talking about this before we went on the air. I get so upset with people having the 12 days of Christmas before Christmas because that's not right. The 12 days of Christmas, and I may have told y'all wrong the other day, 12 days of Christmas starts December 25th and goes for 12 days, goes to January the 5th. Mm-hmm. And then January the 6th is Epiphany, mm-hmm. which supposedly, liturgically, the wise men came. Several years later, the wise men came. It wasn't that same year, I'm sure. But anyway, so that's the 12 days of Christmas. That's the breaking down Christmas. That's the part mm-hmm. we're talking about. From New Christmas to Old Christmas. So Old Christmas this year actually comes on a Saturday. Epiphany's on Sunday. So you all are going to have the event on Thursday.
On a Thursday.
On a Thursday. So let's just get everybody as confused as we can.
Let's get real confused.
January the 10th at the Museum Center. And I've been, I don't know, the last 2 years maybe. Anyway, it's a lot of fun.
It is.
And so kind of tell everybody what we do.
What we do, it'll begin at 6 o'clock. And $5 for non-members. It's free for museum members and guild members. But we'll have some traditional old-fashioned music in the lobby. We'll have simple refreshments. We'll have molasses cookies and cider, things like that.
Ooh.
And we'll have traditional Appalachian stories told by members of the guild. We'll have traditional Appalachian music led by Don and Susan Garrett. They will also teach us play party games.
Yes.
And we will have creative movement.
Creative movement. It'll be all over the place. And the young children that come really enjoy that.
Oh, my. He's just turned three, but he was, what, 2.5 last year. He joined in every one of them.
I know it. He had a big time, and he always drug an adult with him to do that.
Yeah.
So it was a lot of fun to watch the kids and to watch the adults. And we just kind of have to let go of our inhibitions and say, okay, we're back in the 1700s, 1800s, this was entertainment.
It was. Even
this is what you did. We didn't have TV or radio.
Even up until television finally got into the mountains, that was what you did. And I don't know that Old Christmas is actually celebrated much anywhere or in the way they used to. Some places, if you read the Richard Chase book, and I really recommend Grandfather Tales by Richard Chase.
I love that. I have that book. Mm-hmm.
That was our first resource when we first said we're going to do Old Christmas because the book takes place on Old Christmas Eve.
Yes, yes.
And we adapt some of those stories and we've branched out and done more research. Some of the stories date from the 4th century.
Mm-hmm.
It's just wonderful. We'll have at least one spooky story.
Oh.
When you always had to. When you got together and told stories.
Oh, you had to have a spooky story.
You had to have a spooky story, and we have a spooky poem.
Okay.
That I won't recite because I'm a storyteller, not an actor. I couldn't do the memorization. So.
See, I think you're an actor, too, when you're a storyteller. But hold that thought. We're going to take a commercial break, folks, and we're going to come right back with Judy because she's going to finish telling us about this, and then hopefully she's going to tell us, I hope it's not the spooky story, but she's going to tell us a Christmas story and share with us. So don't go away. We'll be right back. Watch our commercials, support our sponsors because they pay our bills, and Judy and I will be right back.